Hello everyone, my name is Dr. Ferox and today I'd like to talk to you about Addison's disease, which is also known as hypoadrenocorticism. It's functionally the opposite of Cushing syndrome. In these patients, they basically do not produce enough corticosteroids. Many of them don't produce any corticosteroids, and this can lead to them having what's called an Addisonian crisis. Corticosteroids do lots and lots of different things. In fact, if you tried to write down all their different functions, you'd end up with a list longer than your arm. We basically divide our corticosteroids into two different groups. We have our glucocorticoids, which are things to do with glucose, and we have our mineralocorticoids, which are things to do with our electrolytes. Our glucocorticoids, in particular, are responsible for increasing our glucose level in the blood. And their main effects are generating glucose from proteins and increasing appetite. Our mineralocorticoids increase our sodium retention, decrease our potassium retention, and that's how they regulate our blood volume. Now, if you have a dog who doesn't have any corticosteroids, initially they have really vague symptoms. They're often just a bit slow, a bit fatigued. Perhaps their appetite isn't quite what it should be, and they often get tired very easily. Most people don't notice these symptoms in the early days, so you can end up with dogs who are having an Addisonian crisis. And these dogs look like death warmed up. They often have a very low blood glucose because they're not actually making any. They often are not eating because there's nothing to stimulate their appetite. Their sodium levels have dropped right through the floor, the potassium levels are super high, and they're hypovolemic, which makes them look very shocky. Addison's disease is sometimes called a great pretender because it can mimic other things. In particular, because the blood volume drops, this often makes very unhappy kidneys. And so they can look like acute kidney failure. They often have a low heart rate because of the high potassium, and they will sometimes also not concentrate their urine, which makes them look even more like a kidney failure case. These dogs will never ever have a stress leukogram though, because they don't have any cortisone to make one. So if we look at this example of an Addisonian dog immediately before diagnosis, you can see lots of different things going on with the blood test. This dog wasn't all that unwell at this stage either, only noticed to be a bit lethargic and not eating quite as well as usual. The symptoms were so mild that they would be ignored most of the time, but luckily for this dog they were not. It's tempting to jump straight to that urea of 27, couple it with the creatinine of nearly 300 and high phosphate and declare that the dog has kidney failure. And if those three features had occurred in isolation, it would potentially be correct. However, this dog has other features of Addison's disease present. The low sodium and high potassium is classic for Addison's. The sodium-potassium ratio is only 22, which is quite low. We also have low cholesterol at about half of what it should be and a low blood glucose, both of which are directly attributable to corticosteroid deficiency and unlikely to occur due to kidney failure. And over on hematology, there is no decrease in lymphocyte counts, called a stress leukogram, which is commonly present in unwell patients but never in Addison's disease. Now, when I say they look like death warmed up, that's a little bit of an exaggeration because they're often hypothermic. And these dogs, they look like they want to die. As in, they're cold, their core body temperature is really low, but they make no effort to get warm. They don't seek warmth, they don't even shiver. And all of this you can reverse if you give them steroids. And it reverses pretty quickly. That said, if you do give them steroids, you can't do the test you need to do to confirm their Addisonian status. But giving them the steroid is less detrimental to the test than letting your patient die. Specifically, the test that we do to confirm this is called an ACTH stimulation test. And in this test, we take artificial ACTH and we give them a massive dose. We would expect our corticosteroid levels to then increase dramatically. But often with these dogs, they don't even blip, and that's considered diagnostic. In the previous case, the dog had no detectable cortisone before the ACTH stimulation test, and it continued to have no detectable cortisone afterwards. This was classic Addison's. Now, typical cases are lacking in both their glucocorticoids and their mineralocorticoids, and so you supplement both, and they go on to live a reasonably normal life, especially if they have an observant owner. Occasionally, we'll get atypical Addison's disease, where the mineralocorticoids are perfectly fine. It's only the glucocorticoids that have disappeared. And that's because these different hormones are made in different layers of the adrenal gland, and if only one of them is destroyed, you will get different symptoms. So how does Addison's disease come about? Well, genetics are a major factor for natural Addison's disease, with purebred female dogs being more at risk, in particular, poodles. But we also know that desexing marginally increases the risk. This is because gonads produce some steroid hormones all on their own. This makes diagnosis in the family a little bit difficult because the breeding dogs are often diagnosed later in life than the non-breeding dogs, at which point they've already had lots and lots of puppies. So a genetic test is in development, and that will be really handy when it becomes available. It's also possible to induce Addison's disease by artificially giving lots and lots of corticosteroids, because then the brain stops producing ACTH, your own adrenals or the dog's own adrenals start producing less corticosteroids, and if you stop those tablets suddenly, you just don't have any. This is why people are always told to wean down their steroids. You can also get it accidentally by over-treating Cushing dogs. If you treat them too far and you obliterate the adrenal gland, you will also end up with Addison's disease. These cases where we've induced the disease by our own actions as veterinarians are called iatrogenic, which means it was kind of our fault. That said, for many people, it is cheaper to treat the Addison's disease than the Cushing syndrome, so some people choose to deliberately do this anyway. So Addison's disease is a sneaky little endocrine disorder. It's often missed if you're not looking for it, at least until the dog's hit an Addisonian crisis, at which point it can still be misdiagnosed if you're not specifically looking for it. Once you have diagnosed it, it's certainly worth treating because these dogs will live a nearly normal lifespan. That's part of the mystery of Addison's disease. Nobody is exactly sure why natural Addison's disease occurs. We think it's immune-mediated destruction of the adrenal gland, but because most of these dogs will live a very long time after diagnosis, when they do get to post-mortem, all that's left is scar tissue, and whatever process was responsible is long gone. But I'm prepared to live with that mystery if it means my patients get to live a long and normal life. Thank you for listening. My name is Dr. Ferox, and I will see you next time.